from our newest project, SANA. It's the first high-rise wooden building in Rotterdam. But this presentation is far more than this project. It's about our approach and experience in open and flexible buildings. Who we are? We are May Architects and Planners. It's an international architectural firm based in Rotterdam. May is founded by Robert Winkel. My name is Robert Platje. I'm one of the associate partners at the office. What are we doing? Our name is Architects and Planners. We have a great expertise in the area of transformation and also in urban planning. On the left side, you see the Schiecentrale, well known, I guess. It's the former energy plant of Rotterdam, where also our office is located. And in the middle, you see Cable District in Delft, very big project. It's the transformation of the former cable factory over there. And on the right side, our project in Russia. It's in Naro-Fominsk, it's close to Moscow. And it's a transformation project of a former silk factory. And of course, we are also architects and planners. And all these projects, what you see here on the display or the screen, you see our fascination of intelligent, flexible building systems. And the left side, the project SANA again. And in the middle, the transformation of the former warehouse, Holland-America line in Rotterdam. It's on Katendrecht. And here we added the new volume of 9 layers on top of that former warehouse. Interesting, it was the biggest warehouse in the world in those days, in 1912. And on the right side, new project, Max and More. That's an energy neutral office building in Buiksloterham. It's in Amsterdam. We are known of our expertise in transformation of old buildings, I guess. On the right side, you see the cheese warehouse in Gouda. And it's an interesting project because it's a listed monument. 1 million kilo of cheese was stored there. And here we were not only the architect, we have also taken the initiative. We were part of the development. So we are also developers. And there was a nice quote in an architectural magazine. You see it on top of the screen. May is blurring and blending and blurring old and new. Quite nice description of our approach to work in the context. If we analyze our working method, we like to work with these 5 core values, actually. First, we are fascinated by the context. It can be the history of the building or the history of the place, the area, but it can also be a social context, the need for a healthy environment, for example. And most of the current buildings are built for anonymous users, and that leads to the result of anonymous buildings, we guess. We like to involve users in the process. What are their specific living patterns? What are their wishes? Shared experience and their shared love for specific building is a good base, we think, to make a strong community. And of course, architecture should be specific in our idea, sublime, with an almost sublime experience, I mean. Architecture, we sometimes do this in collaboration with artists or designers. And the ecological and social need for a different approach to the building environment is, of course, growing. I like to contribute by working on that to create new value systems. And of course, a lot of people are telling the same story maybe, but freedom of users is a core value in our work for almost 30 years now. And this has an effect of the structure of the process. We like to make buildings with the people who will live there, together with them, not making a drawing and then you have to live there, but together with them, creating buildings is what we really like. And of course, here we are. Long-time flexibility should be guaranteed in the structure of buildings by disconnecting parts of different lifetimes. And in the 60s, John Hadraken, of course, he captured these principles in this definition of open buildings. And that's, of course, what we are talking about. You can say the lifespan of bearing construction is, for example, by 200 or 300 years, maybe. You can say the facade, approximately about 100 years. Installation, 30, 50 years, and then you have to replace them or you have to change them. And the finishing by interiors, for example, bathroom, kitchen walls, it has a lifespan of 10 or 20 years. And with this in mind, we designed the Schiescentrale. This is an example of a project in the Lloyd Quartier. It's a vibrant mixed-used area for working, living, recreation. And of course, we do it for the people. You can see here living loft apartments, but also office spaces. Interesting in this typology is the smart grid of disc columns and the disconnection of insulation. Maximum flexibility. In the same grid, living and working is possible. And here you can see the mixed-use programming in the building. The more dark part, that's the parking garage, that's embraced with one-side orientated K dwellings for creating an active plinth. And here you can see how it works in floor plan. On the top part, you see three cores for stability and for this vertical circulation, of course. And with the small stripes, these are the disc columns of concrete. And in the middle of the floor plan, there's a small core. There the shafts are located, the toilets, the bathroom. And the result is a 130 long meter flexible grid. And how does this structure work in time? That's very interesting. This is the principle. We start with three lofts. This is an example. Then another loft pops up. Then the office came in. It's an open loft space. People are changing their floor plans. It's quite fast, this GIF animation. But here you can really can see you start with three apartments and people are changing all the time their floor plans according to their needs in their lives. And interesting is it's not only apartment-wise and living-wise, but it can also be combined with really an architectural office or an office space. And our office was located towards these loft apartments. So it's really interesting that not only at the start of the building you can change or you can choose, but also during the lifespan. This is an example how people live there, some nice pictures. Of course, you can see the disc concrete columns. And it's also flexible in office space. Here you see the different locations on our office. We start to grow, we getting smaller, we move from the 8th floor to the 7th floor, from the 6th floor to the 16th floor, etc., etc. So it's very interesting. If the office grows or is getting smaller, it's possible in this flexible building. Another example, Joop Sveen. It's a former warehouse and a national monument. It was completed in 1913. And as you can see, the building is very closed to protect the goods against weather conditions. And the floor plan, you see there are bearing walls with beautiful cast iron columns and timber floors in a grid of 5 meters. And as I told, the building was very closed. And the question was to transform this into loft apartments. And we came by the solution to introduce three concentrated interventions. So daylight can enter the building. And the apartments has a view. Apartments has a view outside through these three atria. And here you can see the results outside with still the characteristic appearance of a warehouse. And here the lively light atria where the elevators are located and the staircases, of course, for vertical circulations. And also residents can meet here, of course. And the apartments are also in the loft topology. And interesting, you see a typical floor plan. On the right side, it was possible to buy only a Casco, an empty floor with just an electricity and shaft. And it was possible to buy a standard floor plan. You see it in the middle. But at the left side, there's an example of a custom-made floor plan. Actually, whatever you like, you can build over there if you stay with the toilet and the kitchen in more or less 3 meters from out of the shaft. And this is an example of a floor plan or of a loft topology, very beautiful. The outside space are also very beautiful, formal loading decks. People transform it in really nice outside spaces. And on top of the warehouse, we added an extra layer in shed typology for the penthouses. You see here, flexible, lightweight steel construction. And this is an example of the interior in the penthouses. And the residentials are very proud. That's very interesting. They ask a publisher and a photographer, and they made a book of their interiors by themselves. And we have to say we won several prizes with this project, but this booklet is really our biggest compliment. The people are so happy in their own apartment. The third example is Phoenix Lofts as Katen, in Katendrecht. I said it before, we like to involve users in the process. What are their specific living patterns and wishes? Shared experiences, and love for the building. It creates a strong community. And the process of selling these apartments, there are 212 apartments in the end, starts in 2013. It was in the middle of the financial crisis. And the selling process start with this drawing, this is so-called heat map. Red is the most expensive apartment. Of course, it's on the highest level with the beautiful view. And you can't hardly imagine in 2021, but the most expensive apartment was 3,000 euros at those days. Now, approximately, the price is doubled. What is the loft principle over here? The grid was 4.30 meters. It's a little bit typical grid, but it has a relationship with the foundation of the existing warehouse. But for the resident, it was possible to buy an amount of slices of half a grid. And it was also possible to connect apartments vertically. And part of the marketing concept was that a potential buyer or a resident had the possibility to have a meeting with the architect, and he can talk or chat with him for 3 hours to design his apartment, his floor plan. And this is a result of one conversation with the client. And we talked with more or less, I think, 50 different people who now live in the Phoenix. This is the result on building level. The construction principle, on top of the warehouse, we create a huge steel table construction, and above that part, a flexible concrete construction with the disc concrete columns. And here you see a picture of the steel construction. 1.5 million kilo steel is located in this building. And it's really an open concrete construction. You see on left side during the construction. And on the right part, it's interesting how people treat the columns as an interior object. It became a part of their, furniture, actually. And we see it more often in our projects. Here are some examples of columns in our projects. On the left side, Phoenix, steel, big steel column, but also in the cheese warehouse. There are also nice steel, very small columns. Jobs Veen, the cast iron columns, concrete columns, and even green columns in Zara. It's interesting that the column came part of a structural identity element, actually. Here's some examples. This is a house inside the steel table construction. It's 4.5 meters high, you can imagine, with a beautiful view on Kop van Zuid, of course. So this is in the steel table, and this is on top of it. You see different columns. Here's it with completely stucco and white painted columns and ceiling. And the outside spaces with a beautiful view, of course. But now, Sarah, our newest project or current project where we are working on. It's the Rotterdam's first fully wooden 50 meter high residential building. And we developed Sava by ourselves. Here you see Robert Winkel and Mark Compeer. They are the founders of Nice Developers. And together with ERA, we work on this, groundbreaking project. And of course, we like to work in the context. The Lloyd Quartier has a rich maritime history. Can go back to the 1900s. And the Lloyd Pier owns his name to the Rotterdamse Lloyd. It's a shipping company that built a terminal on the Lloyd Pier. And from that spot, from that area, passengers ships departed to the east of the world, like Indonesia. And that's also one of the reasons of the name of the building that we are talking about, as a reference to the eastern rice fields and the history of the place. And here you can see the Sava, the green Sava at the big terraces outside the space. You understand the inspiration of the rice fields, of course. And you can see Sava in the context where it is located, and in the back, a little bit in the center, I see here, you see the former warehouse at Jobs Veen. Starting points are always important to make clear in the start of a project. In the context of, the European Green Deal to reduce the CO2, the carbon emission, almost the entire building is made of wood. And with the designs of Sava, we want to contribute to a healthy living environment, important starting points. And again, we don't do this alone. We want to collaborate together with people who want to live there. And we start the project by selling just 6 apartments to pioneers. Of course, they have more flexibility than other buyers, but it's also a good chance to meet them and to talk with them how they want to live. And the program in Sava is about approximately 100 apartments, dwellings, with 50 rental apartments in the model segment. And that makes it possible for people with, the indispensable professions, like the police officer, the teacher, the nurse, to remain in the city. So they don't leave the city, but they can live in the city. And the deck is the place where people can meet. And below the deck, there's the mobility hub with bicycles and cars, of course. And on the deck, this is the place where people can meet, they can sport. There's a repair room with a shared repair room. So people are working and living together. And as I said before, this is a project fully built in wood. Why wood? And there are, of course, multiple advantages of building in COT, cross-laminated timber. Wood stores CO2, it reduces emission, the construction time can be shorter, living comfort will increase, technical performance, you can make this totally prefabricated. And interesting to, this is how we work in the construction method. It's almost everything is in wood. But of course, you need some parts in concrete for the stability reasons, for example. So the core is prefabricated concrete, and there are some steel columns over there. But most of the material is wood. And interesting to compare, Sana has approximately 4,500 cubical meters wood. And if you calculate the amount of storage of CO2, you can compare it with the emission of approximately 3,000 households in 1 year. And interesting, you need trees, of course, for building such a project in Sala. But each tree, three new ones will be replaced in the forest. You can prefabricate, of course, the construction. Here you see the manufacturer. There's a CLT plate on the left side. And on the right side, you see how cross-laminated timber works. It has different layers of wood glued together. And this is the building system. Of course, an open structure with beams and columns. So there are no load-bearing walls. And that's very important for the flexibility. The building is completely prefabricated. And how does this work? You can see it in the animation, I think. I hope this will work. With glued in steel rods, with prefabricated columns and beams, with CLT floors on top of it. And as you can imagine, you can build it very fast in this construction method. The floor plan. As we showed in other projects, we are making floor plans in columns, no load-bearing walls. But of course, you need electricity and ventilation shafts in the building. But you can increase or make your apartments smaller if you like. And also, an important part is long-term flexibility should be guaranteed in the structure of the building by disconnection parts of different lifetimes. And here you can see the installations in the floor. It's not integrated in the floor like in cast or poured concrete, but it's in a different layer than the COT floor. And that makes the building very adaptable and flexible in time. And here you can see the details, isometric overview with the girders for the balconies. And I have to admit, it's quite complicated to design such a building in wood. There's a lot of investigations how to build it in such a system. But it's very interesting because this is the future, of course, for sure. And we integrated the balconies with flower boxes for urban ecology. There's a little bit strange view, but here you see the floor again with the installations on top of the COT floor. So you can change it later. It's not poured in concrete because you can't detach it anymore, but it's blurred in sand or grind or to make more mass, to add more mass on the floors. Because you can imagine wood is, I think, 1/5 of the weight of concrete. So if you are building in wood, you have problems, difficulties in flanking sound, for example. So you have to add mass on top of a wooden lightweight floor to handle over with sound regulations. And you can do it by putting concrete on top of it, of course. That's how hout is going to build now in Amsterdam. But you can also add a layer in sand or in stones. And then it's possible to detach the installations separately from the construction. And that's very important for the future and circularity in our approach. This can be the result. So this is an overview with a column and a wooden ceiling. It's a very nice result, of course. It's not only about wood or planters. Sustainability is also about biodiversity and ecological parts. The cities continue to grow, of course, and that this has an effect on ecosystems. The habitat of birds, bees, butterflies, and in collaboration with city ecologists and biologists, SANA is designed on a nature-inclusive basis. I mean, not just putting green on it or greenwashing. No, we are really choosing the planting specifically in the location. So depending on the orientation to the sun, the height in the building, and the right plants to attract animals. And the location of SANA is close or near the water. So the typical plants, we design it with wind and the view in mind. And as said, SANA has co-residents designing with, it is hospital with for the humans and the animals. And besides the plants, we addressed several nesting boxes. So we hope we can spot several birds over there. The house sparrow, of course, the bat, but even a falcon, we hope, on the top of the building of SANA. And this will be the result. We hope to start the building at the end of the year or maybe in the beginning of next year. This can be the view. During the time, and of course it's located in Rotterdam with the water taxi with nice images. And please follow this project or our company with the socials, what you see here on the screen, to follow our local and abroad projects. Now there, I hope there's still time for questions,
yes,
Caroline.
There is. Thank you so much, Robert. Yeah.
Okay.
The steel with the floor section, that was your last slide, wasn't it? Maybe it's good to show or not, because
it's interesting. You don't see the slide with the social media?
No.
Really?
We did not. No. This is.
And not with birds and nice things like that?
No,
really?
No. Give them to us. Give us the birds.
Okay, give the birds. I will share it again. Maybe this will help. It's interesting. Oh, so there's a strange story without images. That's
you're a good storyteller. So, yes, we were stuck at the floor section.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see if there's a floor section again. Stuck here.
Yeah, and then.
Oh, and then this.
Oh.
Okay.
Yes.
And so this was the view. Okay.
What kind of column is there, Robert? I mean, is it a tree trunk or?
Yeah, that was the main idea to put a tree trunk in the house. That's where we start because we like the idea to embrace the column as an identity element. But in the end, it was very hard to do it like this in technical way in. Fire regulations and so on, but maybe the next project will be of real trees in the house. Let's see. But for now, it's just a wooden column. Yeah.
To make a small leap to tomorrow. Tomorrow we have the case study lecture with Gaga, Esther Stevelink, and Ari Bersma. Mm-hmm. And they are currently working on a project that will have real tree trunks as columns in Eindhoven.
Ah, yeah.
And it's a technical feat. It's very, very complicated.
Yeah.
But they are still going strong, I believe, in their ambitions.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But this is high-rise building, eh, with 50 meters high and a residential part. So that's very well, very. It's complicated. Yeah. So you don't see this nice images.
No. Please share them again. Oh, the wind and the plants.
Yeah, exactly. I can do it very briefly, maybe. This the view, of course. I start to tell that the part of the Save is not only about wood, but also about biodiversity and ecology part. And we are designing together with very experienced people. And we choose very carefully each plant on different locations, orientations, so that it works very good in this project and that it attracts also animals. And of course, Save is located close to the water side, so there's a lot of wind, actually. And so we are make a composition of high trees, low trees, to deal with the wind, but also to create a nice overview. So lower trees with a nice view, higher trees to project the wind. And this is what I told. We are a Save's hospital for humans and animals, so a lot of inhabitants. And what we are doing is not only making green planters on top of the building, but we are creating nesting boxes to attract nice birds, the house sparrow, of course, the bat, but even a falcon on top of the building, we hope. And this was the image what I showed when I told you that the building will start, we start to build in the end of the year, maybe next year, with a great overview and with the Rotterdam water taxi in front of it. So, and this was the end of the story with the socials, Caroline. Yeah. You can follow the project with our socials. Please do it, because it's very interesting how the project will continue, I think.
And it has its own website, Wonen in Save.
Wonen in Save, that's correct. Oh yeah, and there's an update. I think it's now Wednesday. Yes, they launched the selling process today or tomorrow. So you can see very nice interior perspectives, renders. Just check Wonen in Save. Thank you for the recommendation.
Yes, well, another tip on my part, you also organize online lecture evenings with some of the participants and some of the experts that are involved. And I personally followed one of the lectures with the structural engineer. And it's still on the website, I believe. So for... Yeah.
That's correct. We there's a movie about it. Yeah, we are. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Every Wonen in Save, you can view it back on the website. Yeah. Yeah.
Just to stay with this project before I go to the you can still ask your questions, people in the chat. Before I go to that section, how does the infill strategy work out for Save? Do you sell the like you call them the Costco apartments, or do you already give a sort of an infill to the dwellings before the residents move in?
Yeah. No, we create a kind of base infill, a floor plan, and that's what you can buy. That's what the people are nice developers together with ERA sells to the client, but there's a possibility to change your floor plan. And the six pioneers, they can change it very, how do you say that, brute. They have a lot of freedom. And of course, you can imagine during the process, if you are further in the process, it's harder to change your floor plan, but it's absolutely still possible. But in the beginning of the process, there are more flexibility, of course, and in the end, a little bit less. But we really want to discuss with the people, okay, this is the base floor plan, but these are the possibilities to change the one bedroom, two bedrooms, the different position of your kitchen, for the shower. It is possible.
And do you have the demands of, do you have a sort of a a manual or
exactly.
demands for the materials that are used by the residents for the building, because you have this high ambition with this project, all in wood and CO2 ambitions. Do they have to to use these high levels of ambitions as well in their choices of materials and materials and systems for their individual fit out?
Yeah. They are flexible and free to choose their own parts, of course. But there is a material passport, more or less. And we inform people to use this kind of materials. And together with ERA, they can choose from that part of materials. And interesting is, it works very well, because people who want to live in Sava are very committed to this kind of process. So they're not choosing other materials because they want to contribute for this project. But indeed, there's a kind of material passport. We are creating kind of toolbox, what you can choose or what you can change, because you can't do everything, especially in wood. It's very hard to change everything, of course, especially for the insulation pipes. Of course, that's on building level organized. But the material passport, in combination with the kind of toolbox, what are the flexibility parts of your apartment? That's what we are explaining to the buyers. And we have a conversation with all of them at the end. And we're now talking with the 6 pioneers to see kind of stress test, actually. What do people want, actually? And after it, there's a process going on with the other people who wants to live in Sala.
Yes. I would like to invite one of the people out of the audience, Frank Jonkers. Frank, would you please ask your question to Robert?
Yeah, sure. You said some of your core values were user freedom and community creation. Like, are these separate values, or? Basically, the question is, how do communal areas adapt to their users?
No, it's an integral process, in our opinion. Of course, it's sometimes hard to combine these things, but the ambition is to blend and blur it this as well, because it has a really strong relationship to each other, and it's possible, but with good communication and always talk. What are the core values of this project? You can find out what is more important or maybe less important. And that's a process, of course, that's true. And you always have to make clear, okay, what is the idea? The integrated design is the most hard thing, of course. You have to be aware of all these topics in technical part, but also in community part or biodiversity part, and sometimes it's not on the same level, but then you have to talk together to organize priority, I think.
Okay, and in Sawa, for example, is it like the, I don't remember what you called it, but like the space where the community can meet, is that set in stone right now, or is it?
Yeah. For example, the repair room on the deck level. That's very important. Yeah, that's fixed in the program. Yeah, we organized a place where people can store their repair stuff, and people can use it together. And it's fixed in the VVA description, so-called, so the description how people live in this project. Yeah, we made a description of it.
Okay, thank you.
But I guess the idea to form a workshop in this communal area was something that came from your talks with the pioneers or
and that's so yeah, I'm not sure whose idea it was, but that's a very good example. It can be that there was one idea of people who want to live there. Can we share our repair room? It's a typical example of that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Gardening together, for example.
Okay. Yes, I see that there's one structural engineering question from Tim. Tim, can you please ask your question to Robert?
Yes. Hi. Yes. Okay. I see that my mic is working now. Yes. Thank you for the presentation. Really wonderful. So my graduation focus is basically about demountability in timber high rise. So it was a really interesting project, which was on my radar quite early in the last year. Yeah. So my main question was, I was wondering how the load bearing structure of a high rise building at Sawa would treat stability without the use of a tube in tube concrete core system. So in a lot of these timber load bearing structures, we see these tube in tube concrete cores, which gives stability to the structure, and then mainly the rest of the building is built out of using CLT or DLT timber columns. Mm-hmm. And I was basically wondering, was it ever considered to make the complete structure without any form of concrete except for the foundation?
I switched to the diagrams. This is more the diagrams than what I showed before. Yes, we start to investigate if it's possible without a concrete core, but we find out in a high-rise building, 50 meters high, the thickness of the walls will be very thick in wood, and organize the stability and the floor slab stability as well. So it is possible, but the costs are really high rising then at the moment. I think in the near future it can be cheaper. But what we find out is you really have to see if the material wood is still makes sense for that purpose. So it is technical possible, but the walls are getting so thick and so complicated and high cost that you can ask yourself, okay, is it so important for the building that also the core is of wood? Or are we saying together to each other, okay, we accept this part in concrete and the rest of the building, we are making it completely of wood. And that's all the time the questions during the design process together.
Let me quickly ask a follow-up question to that as well. Because in my graduation research, I've also researched the implementation of, for example, CLT cores. So basically replacing the whole concrete core, as you suggested, and the reduction of the BFO or the usable floor space is ginormous, basically.
Yeah.
looking into different kinds of stability. So you could maybe think of an external diagonalized tube system, as was used in a lot of buildings in Chicago, actually, and also in the Mjøstarnet, which is a completely timber building, which I think you know in Norway. Mm-hmm. So basically, uses these trusses, on the outskirts of the building. It doesn't really use stability from a core. I was just wondering if you guys, thought of that, or maybe this, took that into the consideration of this project.
No, absolutely. The stability is not only the core, I have to say, but there's also the vertical transportation of elevators and so on, of course. There are also stability walls inside the columns, also of wood, with diagonals in it. And there's a study of, okay, is it better to make them in steel or in wood? We can imagine that in the future, it may be cost effective to make the stability hybrid solutions. I think we are going towards that part of the next Sawa, for example. But for this moment, because it's cost effective to create, okay, we just put the core, because that's the whole project is very innovative. And if you say we are innovating everything in the project, it will be so hard job for the building contractor that it's impossible to build. And so we made a decision.
Absolutely.
Okay,
yeah.
The core is okay. Everyone knows how to build a core, and let's do made a big innovation everywhere except the core. That's a strategy. Okay. But of course,
yeah.
we are.
Yeah, I mean.
Yes, well, in
oh, well, I was just going to say.
Yeah. Maybe we can have.
I was just going to say.
Sorry, Tim. You are going to say something.
Yeah. And I was just going to say that I know it's. Obviously, you have to keep it economically viable as well. Yeah, in a real life situation. Just thinking from a graduate student, you know, we try to dream and look at these new examples of, Scandinavian countries.
Keep doing
so
that.
So just wondering. Yeah, for sure. Knowing that hybrid constructions are the future and that you're talking about that as well, it's really,
But the last
giving hope, basically.
The last thing what I wanted mm-hmm. to point out is be aware the Scandinavian projects are hybrid buildings as well, with concrete on the floor.
Yeah.
And we don't have concrete on the floor. That's the amazing part of this project. We don't have hybrid floors. And that's really innovative.
Yeah.
Yes, and Stephen Kendall has something to ask about the floors. Stephen, if you will... Join the conversation, please.
Thank you.
Is this the floor?
Yep. This is a fantastic project. I wish I had known it before. But anyway, the floor system, is that ERA? Is that an ERA product?
No, that's designed by, of course, together with ERA. But there is an engineering company. It's called Perman and Jung. It's located in Switzerland and in Germany as well. And we are working together with them. There's a constructional engineer, of course, Pieters Bouwtechniek, Rob Domen, already mentioned by Caroline Kruid. But Perman and Jung is really specialized in wooden constructions. And together with them, because they are also be aware of building physics with sound impact and so on.
Mm.
And together with them, we study a lot of, we spend a lot of time to find out what is the best floor system. We also investigate a hollow sandwich box system. Quite interesting, a hollow box. You have a small amount of wood on the bottom and a small amount of wood in front of it with a hollow space. And inside the floor, we wanted to put sand and to put extra mass on it and attach the installations over there. So all the installations were prefabricated in that sense, but it's not cost efficient at the moment. The most efficient way is to create a massive wooden floor like you see here on the screen. And you put an extra layer on top of it to put extra mass on it. And then with a floating finishing floor.
Did you have an open tender for this part of the building? Or did you work right from the beginning under some kind of an exclusivity agreement with that Swiss company?
Not very hard because we want to share knowledge and we want to spread the word actually. But there are some parts we and they don't want to share, of course, because we want to build it first and then let's see if we can share the knowledge. But we are very eager to tell something, but the really secret they want to keep it. That's true. But very quite transparent.
So it wasn't an open tender.
No, we are working with Dirix. That's the constructional wooden company. That's the manufacturer of wood, and they work together with Perman and Jung. And we made a kind of open tender with several wooden construction companies like Dirix, but we have also some companies in Germany, and CLTS is also a company in Belgium, for example. And we invited them about their approach, about the costs and how they work. And then we choose for one company to work together with us because you really need it in an earlier stage. It's quite impossible to do it in a tradition way that you design everything and then you say, okay, just build this. Maybe in about a couple of years, we can do it like this, but you really need the intelligence and the knowledge of that kind of engineering companies, especially for in wood.
Thank you.
Yeah, and Robert, the fact that you are the developer as well.
Yeah.
How does that contribute to the level of innovation?
Absolutely important. Absolutely. Why is that? Because if you do it in a standard way, like an investor does, then he is only, well, more or less interested in making profit. And of course, we are interested in making profit, but not in maximization the profit. And that's really the key at the moment, because it's more expensive than a normal building. That's for sure at the moment. I think maybe in a couple of years, it's not a key issue anymore. But because we are our own developers, we can make decisions. We can ask people to collaborate who we want, who really can contribute in the project. And profit is absolutely important, but not on number one. And this is really needed in this kind of innovations. Otherwise, it's quite impossible. And that's also the reason why we took the initiative to create this project.
Yes. Just to step aside from Sawa for a little bit. The open building principles that you apply to this building and to the other buildings that you have shown might give anybody the impression that it is possible to implement open building principles in any building or on any location. Yeah. What is your opinion about that?
nice, Carolyn.
I
think more or less it is. Cannot go back. Oh yeah, I can go back. I think it is possible, but it's a combination with the profit again, because if you make a high rise tower, for example, in 100 meters high, there are always between marks load bearing walls, closed walls. But technically, it is possible to make it open, to make it flexible. But it is true, it costs a little bit more money. And that's always the topic, of course. Flexibility is a little bit more expensive than load-bearing walls. That is true. But you can ask maybe more money or more profit for flexible buildings. That's always the discussion what we have with investors and with developers, of course.
It has to do with long-term and short-term investment and
the quick result. That's really true. That's really true. Yeah. The quick win. Yeah. They are interested in, well, in the quick wins.
Yeah.
But I'm sure if the government, for example, will say, well, you have to build in circular, or you have to deal with the CO2 emission, that kind of things will change, of course. Yeah. But it's not, at the moment, it's not strong enough, because developers and investors can do what they want, actually, in that kind of stuff. But it's not, they don't feel the pressure enough at the moment, I think. There will be, but it's not enough pressure.
Not a moment. Well, then I'll give the last question to Thomas. That is something that has to just fits just nicely in this discussion. Thomas?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your lovely presentation, Robert.
You're welcome. Thank you.
I was wondering, you mentioned that in the Sawa building, perhaps also other projects, you were also the developer. Are you open in the future to do, is it your preference to do everything as a developer, or do you also see benefits in the conventional way with an investor and you as just the architects?
Yeah, of course, because mainly the project world we are working on is with, how do you say, classic developers and investors, of course. But what we like to do is projects like Sawa to go a step further. We want to be in the future. right now. And of course, it's not possible to do it in every project. It makes sense. We understand. We completely understand that. But what we like to do is what we learn from Sava, we can explain to other investors or developers how this is going to work. But we are also be aware if there's only the focus on making profit on the short term, then we don't start talking with them about wooden flexible buildings.
Definitely.
At the moment, maybe in the future, but of course we are aware of different starting points, and that's not really an issue or a problem. Yeah, I think it's a problem for the future, but we have to deal with the starting points. But that's the main reason why we always start with the design principles or the focus in the project. Because if you are talking about it after a half a year, then you are complete behind, and then yeah, it's not going to work. The core values is very important.
Thank you. And maybe a small follow-up question.
Very small.
If we want to shift the balance a bit more towards that architect as a developer side, what in your opinion is missing, if this is possible to answer in a brief
Wow. What is missing?
What would you like to see more of?
In the field, you mean, in the architectural field? Yeah, you have to be aware of processes, of course, and costs, and you have to be very local, I think, because our architecture firm is located near Sava. We know a lot of people in Rotterdam, and that helps, of course. And Nice Developers is also mentioned as a local developer. That's important, because you know the people who want to live there, and you know the people of the municipality. That's the key.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Robert, for, this was a very good lecture. Thank you so much.